Good evening. Welcome to the City of Lewiston City Council meeting, regular meeting agenda of Monday, October 26th. We'll now call this meeting to order. First up on the agenda is Pledge of Allegiance. Please join me in saying the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next item is citizen comments. Let's make a comment before we get into the citizen comments. We have several public hearings tonight, in fact, seven or six of them. So if you're here to testify on behalf or for or against the public hearings, we'd appreciate it if you at least reserve your comments until that time so we get a part of that record. But you're certainly free to come down and talk. It's an opportunity for citizens to address the council on agenda items or other items they wish to bring to the attention of the council. Citizens are encouraged to discuss operational issues in advance with the city manager. And in consideration of others wishing to speak, please limit your remarks to 3 minutes. Do we have any citizen comments this evening? Okay, well, seeing none, we'll go ahead and start our public hearings and presentations. The first public hearing is the Lewiston Transportation Improvement Plan. And this is to solicit public comment and forwarding recommended federal aid transportation projects to the MPO and ITD requesting STP urban funding. Mr. Bennett?
Our Public Works Director, Chris Davies, will make the presentation on this public hearing.
Thank you.
Mayor, City Council, City Manager. This is our annual presentation and an opportunity for the public to comment on our transportation improvement plan. The comment period actually was closed on January 12th, and as you have in your packet, there are some comments from various organizations. One of them is from the Lewiston Clark Valley Bicycle Club. I'm not sure I've got the right chair of the Lewis Clark Bicycling Alliance, sorry, to make sure that's correct. And they have requested some specific changes in the language of the document, and we are going to incorporate those in. But the bigger question, part of this is certainly a review of that, but also to, if there are other projects that council or the citizens feel are important to include in this transportation plan, and then if those get adopted, then finding monies to help process those through the program. At this point in time, we have no additional projects to add to the list. So at this point, we'll be incorporating those comments from the Bicycle Alliance and then anything else that council would like to discuss at this time.
Okay. We also have a sheet of additional comments from the Disability Advisory Commission.
Yes.
And they've been addressed also?
Those will be added in. Once this process is officially closed, we'll include those in all those comments and make those changes into the document.
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Davies? Thanks, Chris. Stick around.
I will.
Okay, I guess at this time we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anybody that wishes to speak to the LTIP program for this year? Okay, well, seeing none, I guess we can close the public hearing. Rebuttal, Mr. Davies?
No, Mayor. No rebuttal.
Okay. I guess at this point, then do we need to adopt? I'd accept a motion to adopt. To forward the recommendations to the FHA and ITD and the MPO for request for funding.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0 with Councilor Daniel absent due to illness. Okay, next public hearing is going to be the area city impact, and this is referring to the code changes. This is going to accept public testimony on the following requested code changes: ZA 0214, revised section 37-183 in paren 8, duties of the Planning and Zoning Commission, and delete section 37-186, appeal from action or ruling of the Planning and Zoning Commission. CA 01-14, revised section 32-3 to delete reference to the ACI, and ZA ACI-1-14, establish zones and administration of ordinances in the ACI. Ms. Von Tersch.
Thank you, Mayor. I've loaded a PowerPoint into the machine, and I think we'll just have to wait for it to catch up to me. If it would be acceptable, I'd like to make one short presentation to cover all of the agenda items, and then ask the council to deliberate on each one and vote on each one separately. And of course, I'll be available for any kind of questions.
Okay.
Well, we use the term ACI a lot, and I thought we'd start with a definition, which is areas that can reasonably be expected to be annexed in the future, considering the trade area of the city and geographic factors, maybe river or mountain range. The area of city impact was negotiated or is to be negotiated by the city and county and consists of three things: a determination on governance, whether city or county, a planning and zoning ordinance for the area, city, county, or hybrid, and a map depicting the area of city impact. A memorandum of agreement was negotiated by the ACI committee, which was made up of three county commissioners, three city council members, and three community members. It's a policy framework that set in motion all of the hearings, ordinances, and resolutions being considered tonight. Governance. It's to be transferred from the city to the county. So as of today, it's city and it's proposed to be county. And to accomplish that, we have two amendments to the city zoning ordinance and one amendment to the city subdivision ordinance to take the city out of the formal review process. We have a plan and an ordinance for the area. The memorandum of agreement directs that the city and county staff confer on the plan. So from my perspective, the first step was to clean the slate by deleting the existing comprehensive plan narrative, and that would be your plan amendment 0214. To negotiate new narrative with the county staff, which is comprehensive plan amendment 3-14. But we didn't quite get there in terms of agreement on all the language. And I can step you through exactly where this is in your packet at the appropriate time. But the top of the language, which setting out, you know, what are we trying to achieve with an ACI in the comprehensive plan? And it at the heading of the page, it indicates that urban development belongs in city. But if you go down further, policy 3 actually says urban development can be adjacent to incorporated cities. And I object to that language. The city council, you know, may make their choices, but I was unable to agree to that language. And the county disagrees with policy 6, requiring construction of platted rights of way with adjacent development. The draft zoning ordinance, ordinance 4626, was jointly developed by the city and county staff. That ordinance will be administered by the county staff, county P&Z, and the county commission. I have a map of the proposed ACI boundary. Maybe I should just ask somebody to come bail me out on this computer. Mr. Smith, could you try, please? You know, I did as good as I could. I stuck the thingy in the hole. That's as far as I could get. But so we have a map of the ACI boundary, which, oh, I needed to move the mouse. Dang it. Thank you. We have a map of the ACI boundary, and okay, it's in the thumb drive. There we go. Which will become part of our plan, our comprehensive plan. And then finally, just since we're on this subject, I thought it was time to look over the city annexation policy, and it predates state statute, and I think it begs the question if it's in compliance with state statute. So I wanted to repeal that and recognize that we're going to follow states. All right. Governance. So there's the map. This is the new proposed map that reduces the ACI from what we had today. And it may or may not be real apparent to all of you, but it's the hatched area outside of the heavy line. So each one of these squares, But each one of the squares, you can see the grid squares are 640 acres. So you can see as we move along the eastern edge of the city and then the north boundary, that quite a bit of the acreage is to be removed. That completes my presentation, and we can take up each one of these subjects at your leisure.
Any questions for Laura? Councilor Randall.
One thing I would like to make note of, apparently, some of our people feel that they have a choice. There is a choice between whether the city administers the area of impact or the county does. And unfortunately, there is no alternative. The Idaho Supreme Court, in its infinite wisdom, felt the Constitution was very specific on that and said that anything outside of the city limits is county, and anything inside of the city limits is city, period. And that's the way it's going to be with the area of impact.
Councilman Randall, I think your position would be completed if we added the fact that in the area city impact, the city does not have jurisdiction over zoning enforcement or the issuance of building permits, but the plan and the zoning can be negotiated and can be either city or county. And in the case of the ACI as it is today, our Planning and Zoning Commission makes recommendations to the County Commission in regards to zoning ordinances and subdivision maps.
Mr. Mayor. It's my understanding there is a statute that specifically says that the city has a right to make recommendations to the planning and zoning and the county commissioners, but that doesn't mean they have administrative capabilities.
Well, and if I may?
Sure.
That was one of the arguments I kept bringing up when we had the group of nine, was the fact that even though the city's Planning and Zoning Commission was reviewing things in the area of city impact, they didn't have the authority. They'd only had the authority to make a recommendation because the county commission always had the ultimate authority on what happened in the area of city impact. So, I mean, I agree with what you said in theory, but I would agree with Ms. Von Tersch's interpretation of that also, that we never really had, the city P&Z never really had authority. It just was a perception, I think, by a lot of people that happened to reside out there that the city was telling them what they could and couldn't do. And that was not the case. So, further questions? Okay, well, thanks, Laura. Don't go too far. Actually, before you leave.
Yes, sir.
So we'll go ahead and open up the public hearing.
For the first item on the agenda, which would be the co-changes.
Okay, code changes. That's item B
on
our agenda.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, we'll go ahead. This time we're going to go ahead and open up the public hearing. Is there anybody that wishes to speak to the area city impact code changes that the city's proposing? For or against? Okay, seeing none, I guess we'll go ahead and close the public hearing.
Mayor? If I may, Just for clarification, no action is required by the council following any of these three public hearings. There are action items following those in the form of ordinances.
Ordinances.
Right.
In the active agenda.
Right.
Thank you. Okay. But I would like to ask a question again. So when you're referring to, you know, voting separately on the three different issues, you weren't talking specifically to the three issues on the code changes.
No,
that's the whole package, correct?
Right. I wanted, or I was hopeful that you would take the one staff report, hold three public hearings, and then move on to the slate of ordinances and resolutions, starting with 4621, which is on your active agenda, or 4622, your active 4622, agenda.
4623, and then 4621.
H. Yeah, A through okay. H.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, everybody clear on that? All right, the next public hearing is the Area City Impact Comprehensive Plan Amendments. Accepting testimony on the following requested comprehensive plan amendments is CPA 02-14, delete Lewiston Comprehensive Plan Chapter 6.8, narrative concerning future land uses in the ACI, and delete Lewiston Comprehensive Plan Design Directives for the ACI found on pages 14 through 1411 and 1412. And then CPA 03-14, adopting the narrative for the ACI and a vision for annexed areas. And then CPA 04-14, adopt the 2014 Lewiston ACI boundary map with accompanying legal description, which we have just seen. And you pretty much covered that. So I guess at this time, we'll go ahead, since this is the comprehensive plan amendment, we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anybody that wishes to testify to the changes to the comprehensive plan amendments for the city? Okay, seeing none, I guess we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Lively crowd tonight. Next up, public hearing annexation policy. This is going to be accepting testimony on a request to repeal Resolution 94-78, the annexation policy in its entirety. And I would ask you to, if you could come forward and just go over this so people understand what we're trying to accomplish here.
The existing annexation policy was developed approximately 16 years ago. And it includes a pretty extensive laundry list of things to consider that some of which are they don't seem appropriate at this time. And it's really, from my perspective, geared towards the involuntary annexation process established by statute, where we would be demonstrating that we had the capability of providing the service. And I just don't see that as compelling from the standpoint that the city does not take such an aggressive position on annexation. In fact, we almost only consider voluntary annexations, which have a much simpler process identified in statute.
Okay. Any questions? Are we clear on that? Thank you, Laura. Okay, we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. For any comment, for or against, on our annexation, repealing our annexation policy? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Okay, on to lighter stuff. Public hearing for the building code. Accepting testimony on the modification of Chapter 10 of the Lewiston City Code to repeal the current 2009 codes and replaced with the 2014 International Building Code, 2014 International Energy Conservation Code, 2014 International Mechanical Code, 2014 International Fuel Gas Code, 2009 Idaho State Plumbing Code, 2014 National Electrical Code, 2014 International Existing Building Code, 2014 International Residential Code, and the 2014 International Property Maintenance Code in compliance with Idaho State statutes.
Our building official, John Smith, will go ahead and make the presentation.
Mr. Smith.
Mayor, City Council. I want to thank you tonight for listening to this. This is a relatively routine process that we go through about every 3 years. The state of Idaho goes through a negotiated rulemaking process through with 14 different local, state, and federal agencies to come up with their new code changes. And most generally in whole, we adopt them as they are presented by the state of Idaho, or we have to reopen that negotiated rulemaking process. This had been reviewed by my Building Code of Appeals Board, and we move forward with these documents as they're presented by the state.
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Smith? So just to clarify that this is something that we are routinely required to do because of the state. We have to adopt the state.
The state.
What the state adopts, we have to adopt.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All clear on that? Yeah. Councilor Randall.
Something might point out on those, we have to adopt the state, but we can adopt something a little more restrictive than the state.
We can, as long as we reopen the negotiated rulemaking process with all those different agencies.
Yeah, we can't relax the state standard, but
right.
We can tighten it. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Smith. Okay, we'll go ahead and open this public hearing. Is there anybody who wishes to speak in favor or against adopting the 2014, for the most part, building codes as adopted by the state? Okay, well, seeing none, I guess we'll close the public hearing. And our next and last public hearing, which is a vacation, VA07-2014, the applicant, C.S. Bloom Properties, accepting testimony on a request for the vacation of a dead-end portion of the 27th Avenue and Short Street right-of-way. Mr. Hayhurst.
Mr. Mayor and council members, as always, it's a pleasure to be here tonight. The vacation that I'm presenting tonight has to do with the C.S. Bloom Properties for, like you said, Mr. Mayor. And it's this is being represented tonight by Curtis Bloom as the owner. Mr. Bloom is requesting that a dead-end portion of 27th Avenue and Short Street be vacated to create a more consistent west boundary for his apartment project and to increase the size of his property. This vacation would also benefit the adjoining residential landowners by eliminating a driveway encroachment in the public right-of-way. The natural drainage way and any existing utility lines are proposed to be protected and access maintained by reserving easements. The requested vacation area is located north of Stewart Avenue, south of Vineyard Drive, east of 14th Street, and west of 17th Street. It consists of portions of 27th Avenue and Short Street as dedicated by the Lewiston Vineyards Track Number 1 plat. I'll throw up here on Elmo some drawings to get you oriented. Don't have a pen, so I guess I'll use my finger. The red area here in the middle You can see that area, that's where the vacation is going to be. Roughly rectangular area, and as you can see, it's centrally located here. It's the area where the apartments are being built right now is this general area right in here. This little area actually is an area that was left over from prior vacations, which I'll get into in just a minute. Now, to blow that area up a little bit, let you see some detail of this second image. Hopefully that red boundary you can see around there, it's a very kind of an unusual area, the boundary of this thing. But it's basically falls in the bottom of this drainage that comes down from up above here on Stewart, flows down and goes through Short Street here and then over Short Street into a developed drainage. It is a major part of our stormwater system in this area. Here is a composite plat map that kind of shows you the complexity of the area and what's happened over the years. Skipping down to the history in your notes in the staff report that I gave you. Originally, this area was subdivided by the Lewiston Vineyards Tract Number 1 plat in 1912. A portion of 27th Avenue adjacent to the requested vacation area was conveyed to a private landowner by Nez Perce County in 1967. That's this little area right in here, kind of a notch out of the area being vacated. So that was accomplished in 1967. The area was annexed into the city of Lewiston in 1969 in the big annexation of the orchards. Then there was an alley located to the west and adjacent to the requested vacation area that was vacated by city ordinance 3222 in 1974. That's this long alleyway here. And so the alleyway that's adjacent to the portion being proposed to be vacated has already been vacated also. So this really is a standalone dead end area in every sense of the word. And of course, an adjacent portion of 27th Avenue located to the east was vacated in 2014 by council action under VA 03-2014, and we're talking this whole area over to the side here and where the apartments are now being built. In discussion, or in compliance, excuse me, with the current Lewiston Vacation Ordinance, Mr. Bloom has submitted the necessary applications, submitted consent letters from the two other adjacent landowners, who are Jeremiah and Marina Robbins, and Reuben and Tracy Russell, and paid the vacation petition fees. City staff has solicited comments from utility providers and other departments and agencies, set and advertised a public hearing for the vacation, provided notice of the public hearing by certified mail to all landowners within 300 feet of the requested vacation area, and posted the requested vacation area with public hearing notice signs. The requested vacation area contains some private landowner improvements and a natural drainage channel that is part of the city stormwater system. The private landowner improvements include a paved driveway with adjacent curb and private sidewalk, a keystone retaining wall, and landscaped areas. With the requested vacation area being a dead-end portion of 27th Avenue and Short Street, the city has no current or future plans to construct a street in this area. It was determined in the previous 2014 vacation action that it was not feasible to construct a street in the 27th Avenue right-of-way as platted in 1912 because of the steep terrain and the fact that Short Street provides a connection to another developed city street. If the requested vacation is approved, the landowners adjacent to the vacated right-of-way will take possession of the vacated land as specified by the council decision. Both Idaho State Code, Section 50-311, and the Lewiston Vacation Ordinance state, whenever any street, avenue, alley, or lane shall be vacated, the same shall revert to the owner of the adjacent real estate, one half on each side thereof, or as the city council deems in the best interests of the adjoining properties. The proposed division of the vacated property would give the Robins the area containing all of their private improvements and a portion of the slope east of their driveway. The Russells would receive a small area adjacent to their eastern property line where they desire to expand a small parking area. C.S. Bloom Properties 4 would receive the remainder of the vacated area. City staff has spoken to all three of these parties and they all desire to have the vacated area divided in this manner. And if I can find the right image again, I will show this image and I will point out those areas to you. C.S. Bloom Properties, the way we have the division proposed, C.S. Bloom Properties would get this area to the side over here, which contains mostly drainage channel and a little bit of slope on the east side. The Robins would receive the area here on the west side of the vacation area, which as you can see, especially in this area right in here, includes a good portion of their private driveway, their private sidewalk, a stone column they've built down there with their address on it, and landscape areas here to the side. And as you come up, it also includes a little bit of their parking area up near the south end of their property. As I understand it, they have, they desire this little portion of property down the slope on the east side of their curb, so they can do some landscaping, maybe plant some trees or some bushes or something like that along those lines to help as a buffer there. The Russells want this little rectangular area down here, and that's only so they can expand this little parking area they have in the lower portion of their lot. So they can park, I believe they want to park an RV down in that area, and that would allow them to do that. To give you an idea of what this really looks like, I went and took some photos. Here's a photo of me standing in Short Street, looking toward the south, looking up Robin's driveway. Now these red lines that I've drawn on here is my best representation that I could do, lacking being an accomplished artist, of where that vacation would actually fall on the ground. So you can see that it would be an asset for them to have their driveway, their sidewalk, and so forth down in this area. Now there's a dash line that comes right up through this area. That would be the limit of what they would be receiving. This area down in the bottom would be what C.S. Bloom would be receiving. And hidden in the back there, you cannot see what the other landowner would receive in the very back there. This is standing at the top of the Robins driveway and looking north. So again, you can kind of see what's going on. The vacation area, that part that sticks out that includes a lot of their driveway is difficult to see. You're looking at almost on edge here, so it does cross their driveway though there. And you can see from this dash line here over this direction, that's what they would receive down in here for their landscaping buffer type ideas that they have there. Lastly, here's a photo where basically I turned around from that last photo and took a photo toward the south, looking at the Russell's property. Here you can actually see a little bit more about what he's talking about there. Behind that fence, he has a little parking area. When this vacation goes through, and if it's allocated like we're proposing, he would get a little bit of this area down in here, down this slope a little bit, which would actually enable him to push out just a little bit here and enlarge his parking area here, which is his goal in this whole thing. There are also two utilities that have existing installations in or near the requested vacation area. Avista has an overhead power line that crosses over the northwestern corner of the area, and LOID has a water line and a fire hydrant near the northeast corner of the area. The request for vacation comments resulted in a no-comment response from Lewiston Transit, the fire department, the police department, the city attorney, and the city street maintenance manager. A response of no objection was received from the city planner, the city surveyor, the city water and wastewater managers, Sunshine Disposal, and the city parks and recreation department. No response was received from CenturyLink, the school district, and the airport manager. The Lewiston Community Development Director had no objection to the requested vacation, but wanted to make sure that the allocation of the vacated right-of-way to the abutting landowners is allowed by state and local statutes. I think we've covered that with what we've said further up in the process here. Avista Cable One and LOAD had no objection to the requested vacation, but wanted public utility and maintenance access easements reserved. The city stormwater program coordinator had no objection to the requested vacation, but wanted public drainage and access easements reserved. The requested right-of-way vacation area is approximately 0.339 acres with an approximate value of $25,400 based on Nez Perce County assessment value of the three adjacent land parcels. Recommendations. The staff recommends that the City Council approve the requested right-of-way vacation with the following conditions. Number one, as allowed by state statutes and the city vacation ordinance, the allocation of the request or the vacated area will be made as follows. CS Bloom Properties will receive 10,795 square feet, which was as shown in that diagram that I or that image, GIS image that I showed you. The Robins will receive 5,998 square feet, and the Russells will receive 300 square feet. And condition number two would be a public utility drainage and pedestrian access easement will be reserved over the entire area being vacated. That concludes my presentation. We'd be open for any questions you may have.
Any questions? Councilor Blakey?
Just wondering in this whole process, how did this not get discussed in the very beginning? I was just curious why it wasn't brought up when we first started talking about land use up there and the debates to the public. Is, if I remember right, some of these folks whose property this is affecting may have spoken out against this development at one time or another. And now we're coming back and readjusting some of the property lines. Again, why would it not have come up in the very beginning?
You know, when the proposed apartment project was getting going and they did request that initial vacation, we looked at this area down there. The city was kind of neutral because it could either stay as public right of way because we needed it for drainage. We want to maintain it as a public drainage way. So we were kind of neutral. We thought, okay, it doesn't really matter whether it's covered by an easement so much as it is or a public right of way. So, and the developer at that time did not want to vacate this portion. That's kind of how our system works is when someone comes in, they propose to us what they would like to see us vacate. We look at it from the city perspective. If we have strong feelings one way or the other, of course, we make that known at that time. This was an area that was sort of, yeah, if it was in it, that's fine. If it wasn't in it, it really wouldn't affect the city that much. So that's my understanding of why it was left out of their original request. So they brought this one up just recently. We've considered this one on its own merits and believe that from the city perspective there is no downside to this. Obviously from the apartment side they see no downside or they wouldn't have asked for it and gone through the process. And from what I understand from the adjacent owners, they see no downside. They only see upside on being able to control more of that adjacent property that they would like to develop in different ways or have already developed. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Other questions? Okay, thanks, Dan.
Mm-hmm.
Go far. Okay, is the appellant here? Have anything to add to the discussion or? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bloom. Okay, I guess we'll go ahead and open this public hearing to take testimony for or against vacation VA07-2014. Is there anybody that wishes to testify? Name and address for the record, please.
Marina Robbins, 1446 27th Avenue. Mr. Hayhurst did a lovely job explaining, but my husband and I are for the vacation.
Okay. Well, thank you. Anybody else? Okay. I guess we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Any further comments? Or I have just one question, just for clarification. So by approving this, we are going to retain a public utility drainage easement.
Exactly. That's what my recommendations would be. A public utility, drainage, and pedestrian access easement. You know, if you've been up there, we have that pathway through there now, mm-hmm. that the apartment developers have built. And basically, this would make it, the pedestrian access kind of adds that area there too. So it would be reserved for utility use, drainage, and for public enjoyment, really, at pedestrian access.
Okay. All right, thank you. Further questions? Okay, so we need a motion to approve. I'd entertain a motion to approve vacation VA07-2014.
So moved.
With the conditions.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion? I'll just say one thing. I haven't really walked the path, but I've taken the time to look at it from top and bottom, and I think they did a nice job connecting Stewart down there into the neighborhood, so I'm for it. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Okay, moving on to the consent agenda.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move item C down into the active agenda.
Item C will become item L, correct?
Correct.
We had an item L that's been stricken.
Correct.
Okay. Okay. Any others? Those in favor of reading the consent agenda as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the minutes of the January 5th, 2015 work session and the January 12th, 2015 regular meeting. Accepting the meeting minutes of the December 4th Historic Preservation Commission, January 19th, 2015 Parks and Recreation Commission, and the November 12th, 2014 Youth Advisory Commission. And approving the vouchers payable dated January 1st, 2015 through January 15th, 2015 in the amount of $1,462,809.88.
Okay, councilors, the consent agenda has been read. I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as read.
So moved.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Is there discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Okay, moving on to the active agenda. First item is item A, ordinance 4622 for the first reading, amending City Code Section 37-183, parentheses 8, duties of the Planning and Zoning Commission to review and comment as appropriate to Nez Perce County on land use proposals within the area of city impact. I'll entertain a motion to read ordinance 4622 for the first time.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there discussion? Do you have something to add? Okay. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the first reading of ordinance 4622 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Lewiston amending Lewiston City Code Section 37-183-8, changing the designation of the Planning and Zoning Commission for the area of city impact and providing an effective date.
Okay, moving on to item B, which is ordinance 4623, first reading. This is repealing City Code Section 37-186. I'll entertain a motion to read ordinance 4623.
Second.
Okay, motion's been made and seconded. Discussion. Okay, just to reiterate, this is the one that's changing city code, providing for an appeal of area city impact applications to Nez Perce County Board of County Commissioners. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Approving the first reading of ordinance 4623 by title only. An ordinance of the City of Lewiston repealing Lewiston City Code, Section 37-186, and providing an effective date.
Okay. Ordinance 4623 has been read. Next up, ordinance 4621 for first reading. This is amending City Code Section 32-3, removing the reference to Idaho Code Section 50-1306 and the area city impact. I'll entertain a motion to read ordinance 4621 for the first time.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the first reading of ordinance 4621 by title only. An ordinance of the City of Lewiston amending Lewiston City Code Section 32-3. Removing the reference to Idaho Code Section 50-1306 and the area of city impact and providing an effective date.
Okay, ordinance 4621 has been read for the first time. Item E, ordinance 4620, or item D, I'm sorry. D, right?
Yeah.
Thank
yes.
you. Mm-hmm. Getting ahead of myself. Ordinance 4624 for the first reading, repealing section 6.8 of the comp plan and enacting a new section 6.8 and adopting a map of the Lewiston Comprehensive Plan area. I'll entertain a motion to read ordinance 4624 for the first time.
So move.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Randall, any observations? Councilor Blakey?
No.
No.
Okay. Ms. Van Tersch.
Mayor and Council, I wanted to again reiterate that there was not complete agreement on this language between the city and the county staff. So I'd like to identify that for you. So on Appendix A of your ordinance, Policy 3 at the bottom of the page, which reads, Nez Perce County should encourage moderate to high density residential and or commercial development to locate in or adjacent to incorporated cities. The Lewiston staff objects to the language or adjacent to, believing that urban development belongs in cities and not on the fringe, where it will be a barrier to annexation and future development with a rational land use pattern. The second point of disagreement is on the next page, Policy 6, which reads, in the Lewiston ACI, Nez Perce County will require construction of all platted rights away with adjacent development. And the city, the county commission objects to that language.
Okay, where are we at?
Oh, if you go to ordinance 4624.
Okay.
Okay. 4624 on the second page, policy 3. The city staff would like the language or adjacent to stricken. And on the following page, the county commission would like policy 6 stricken.
Question, Mayor.
Yes.
is the language that is present in the ordinance as presented to the council, the language that was recommended by the city's Planning and Zoning Commission?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So, I guess where we're at is, if anybody wants to amend or...
Well, I mean, it's up to the council to initiate any discussion if you wish to.
Yeah.
To debate any of the points that are presented in the ordinance or not, and move forward. So, your pleasure.
Okay. Well, I'll say this. Having gone through many, many, many months with the group of nine that came forward with this, I don't think it was the, in my opinion, not maybe the best effort, but I think it was a somewhat workable agreement, and I think we all pretty much signed off on it at that time. And I did have some few reservations, but at this point in time, it has gone through our planning and zoning process. They have presented it to us, and if it doesn't work out, I guess we can start another party of nine.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually what would happen at some point down the road. If there still remain discrepancies that the county and the city can't work through together, after adopting the ordinances that change their respective codes and plans, you know, if you can't reach agreement on those remaining items, then potentially, yes, we could end up going through the same process again.
Okay. Yes.
That's not entirely correct. I'm sorry. What the code, what the state statute says is that you go through the process of negotiation, and if you can't reach an agreement, it goes to state court. Now, that doesn't preclude you from, on those two items or whatever those items are that you're in disagreement with, going back and trying to enter into some kind of discussions with the city, either through city staff, which I think is probably the preferable, to see if you can reach some agreement on it, or to have some kind of joint meeting to see if you can reach some agreement. But if there is no agreement, we don't start the process over. It goes to court.
Well, we sign off on this, and languages all pretty much agree from the county and the city. Then if an issue comes up, then we can go back and say, hey, it's time that we sit down and meet again and have another group of nine. That's where this all started,
yes,
correct?
Yes, once this is signed off on. But you've entered into the negotiation process on this issue. So, I mean, if you've agreed on everything and they pass ordinances, we pass ordinances, everything's okay, let's say a year from now, an issue comes up and we can't agree, then you can go back and reinstitute the process. But on this particular process, you've already gone through the group of nine meetings on it. So if there's no agreement in the end, and you can't agree on certain issues, then whatever you can't agree on goes to district court by statute.
Okay. Everybody clear on that?
There's nothing that precludes you from trying to work out that those issues before the end of the...
Before that happens.
Before that happens.
Okay.
Could... when we vote on it, could we make the motion that we're voting on it with the understanding that our staff will meet with county staff and work out these differences by a set time?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. When you vote on it, what?
Could we make a motion that we will accept the proposed ordinance with the stipulation that our city staff work with the county staff to take care of those areas of differences by a certain time period?
Yes, you can, and that would be appropriate to do on the third reading of adoption.
On the third
okay.
reading.
Right. Okay.
You're only in the first reading right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
But if you want to direct city staff to try and work those problems out right now, you certainly can do that.
Well, we will, and then so we'll have three readings.
Correct.
It's kind of like the budget.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everybody keeps quiet our first two rounds, and then we go for it. So, okay, I'll make a note of that. And then with that being said...
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
I just have a question. I think in reading this, policies three, I can understand why the city might object to that. I just need, if one of you three that were part of this, I'd like to understand, if I could, the county's perspective on the objection with number six. What does this actually mean, or why would they have issue with number six?
She's here.
Ms. Thompson?
We have the county planner here.
Allison Tompkins, Nez Perce County Planner. The reason the county's objecting to that is based mostly upon the language that the committee agreed upon to allow for three different development options in the county subdivision ordinance, which does apply to the area of city impact. And so that, I don't have it in front of me right now, but that policy number six is a statement about requiring the construction of rights of way at the time of development, which is inconsistent with the three options that the committee agreed to.
Yeah, I remember the three.
I thought
three subdivision options.
Okay. Thank you.
Absolutely.
The memorandum of agreement speaks to the timing of infrastructure construction with subdivisions. The policy that I have drafted for you speaks to construction of improvements, which is to say a house. So if a house is adjacent to a platted right-of-way from the old Orchards plat, we would request that the road be built at that time. And there's a really simple reason for that. When person's buying a piece of land, when a person is preparing to construct a house, it would be known upfront that that would be a cost that they would incur. So you could say, yes or no, it's a deal breaker. You could say, that's fine, roll it into my 30-year mortgage, we'll amortize it. You can make some choices as a consumer. But this notion that came out of the memorandum of agreement that the city would come in later and build these improvements if they were so needed is really saying that the larger tax-paying public will be subsidizing the interests of one developer who built that house. And so you could say it's inconsistent with the memorandum of agreement if you want to interpret that to include all development, but it actually only says subdivisions.
Correct. Not single family dwelling.
Yeah. But
okay.
Their county's definition of subdivision, if I'm right, is two, right? Two houses.
So. Yes, the county's definition, well, the county subdivision ordinance requires that any land division within the area of city impact of Lewiston be platted. And the reason that requirement was added last year when the ordinance was updated was to allow an opportunity for additional input and standards and oversight by the city.
Okay.
There are approximately 200 acres in the East Orchards that are not now recognized as 5-acre parcels, but could be because they were platted. And the county's position on those parcels is that they're legal, I agree with that, and they can come forward and be recognized subject to their codes and ordinances. But what they don't say is that their codes and ordinances don't speak to pulling a specific building permit to apply the standards. And so when I've inquired about this, well, would you make that change? They said no. But so they're recognizing a plat from 1910, but they're not recognizing that that part of that plat was building streets adjacent to these lots. So they're not requiring that the streets be constructed. And I think Powers and Grell were probably constructed by the irrigation district. And that's why we don't have north-south streets or quarter-section streets. And this is a fine policy choice. I'm just saying that it's not the best policy for the city.
Okay.
Speaking of which.
I
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
I asked this about, I sent an email to Laura about this, and she went to LOID and asked them about it, and their legal thing said, or legal person said, it didn't have any bearing on the East Orchards because it wasn't the area of impact was not within their jurisdiction. But one of the things maybe we need to look at is have our city attorney look into Idaho Code 31-3805. And it
says...
Could
you repeat that?
31-3805. And see if there's any chance it might apply. What it is it says if... It says, when either a subdivision within the meaning of Chapter 13, Title 50 Idaho Code, or a subdivision subject to a more restrictive county or city zoning ordinance is proposed within the state of Idaho, any and all part of said subdivision would be located in the boundaries of an existing irrigation district or other channel companies, ditch association, or like irrigation water delivery entity, hereinafter called irrigation entity. For the purpose of chapter, no subdivision plat or amendment to the plat or map recognized by the city county for a division land will be accepted, approved, or recorded unless, and then they got a long list of different things. I'm wondering if we go to annex a property in the area of impact, if that would also more or less automatically include LOID, that they could expand their drinking water boundaries.
Well, I think they already have irrigation water outside the city limits, well into the area of city impact.
So I would suggest our city attorney look, review this code and see if it applies in this case, and maybe that will just solve the whole problem.
Here. Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Council Blake.
Question for Laura.
Okay.
Laura, besides your example of the 5-acre plots in the East Orchards, are there other areas in the area of impact that you feel would be affected by the examples that you're giving right now where we may have growth and there should be further continuation of roads, but because of the county definition, city definition, are there other examples of that within that area that you can pinpoint?
Well, I could help you recall the Greco subdivision of approximately 2 years ago, maybe three now, where we were processing the subdivision and we were very concerned about the extension of roads. And we were not upheld on that point by the county commission, even though we had recommended that the roads be extended as shown on the plats and as recommended by the long-range transportation plan that the county commission sits on that board and voted for. And they had reasons for that, but we did not prevail. And it was unfortunate. Because when you put houses in the middle of what should be platted right-of-way, the right-of-way is never going to be built.
No, I'd agree.
Okay, so stepping back from this, you know, why do we care about these platted right-of-ways? In one of the original staff reports prepared for the Planning and Zoning Commission that was submitted to the City Council a few months back, we went through an exercise where we showed the land use density on the 5-acre lots and the placement of houses and the roads and what that value was and what the value could be achieved if we had something like the Lutz Edition or the new property out off of Burl and 18th.
Estates of Canyon Crest.
Thank you very much. And hands down, it is far better for the city to conserve their land base by having three and a half units per acre and have three and a half units per acre providing a tax base for the service demands for the road maintenance, water and sewer line, et cetera, than to have the other alternative. And I think I showed you the map pretty clearly that it's a factor of 10 times or 20 times. And if we allow those 5-acre lots to go in without platting the right-of-ways, today's person is going to say, this is a beautiful house and I love it. It's my dream house. I'm going to be there forever. But what we've seen through the orchards over time is that the next guy down might have a different desire. And his desire might lead to a land division, and then we get flag lots, and we have these discontinuous streets. And we're lucky to achieve one house per acre under that haphazard pattern. I'm just trying to help the city grow in a sustainable way and conserve our financial and our land resources.
Okay. Thank you. Well, no, there's a lot of things to ponder here, and I'm glad it is just the first reading, because I would certainly hope that we can get the city and county to sit down at some point in time and try and really hash these out. I know that it's been worked on, but perhaps if we're going to go through with three total readings, maybe there'd be a little more sense of urgency the city's already given a fair amount to the county on this, giving up a boundary, which we just did 7 years ago, and not allowing or changing the way that we administer the area city impact just strictly through the Nez Perce County Planning and Zoning, with really a token effort of mutual agreement on, you know, if there's something big, yes, we'll talk to the city type of deal, but really nothing's been defined there. So I think that, and I don't see anything getting annexed anytime soon, but that day will probably come. You know, whether it's 30 years from now, might be 50 years from now, but again, to face a situation like we currently have in the orchards, particularly the East Orchards, where the city annexed it, and I guess they made a bunch of promises about sidewalks and roads for everybody up there, but couldn't happen because of the way the streets were constructed. I live on a 20-foot right-of-way, and that was county property at the time. So I guess I would go ahead and still entertain a motion to read this for the first time, and then knowing we have two more shots at it, maybe some people can get their heads together and make some changes. So, Councilor Blakey.
Who would you want those people to be in a perfect world?
In our perfect world, I would think that the planning department of Nez Perce County and the planning department of the city of Lewiston.
I agree.
So, and perhaps a department head or city manager and a county commissioner or a mayor and a county commissioner, it doesn't matter to me.
You had to make me weigh in on this, didn't you? What we have already done is to cede development authority for the planning area of the area city impact to the county. We no longer have any authority to approve projects within the ACI. The county has that full authority through the County Planning and Zoning Commission and through the Board of County Commissioners. They have said, of course, that they are going to refer items within the area of city impact to the city for comment. I question whether or not the city can require the county to do anything, unless you're willing to, you know, reach one of those points of no meeting of the minds, as the city attorney referred to. So I certainly understand the community development director's concerns about the platting of the right-of-ways in the area of city impact. But it is true there was a three-tiered approach to that, and that because the likelihood of the properties closest to the area of city impact boundary with the city would be the ones most likely to develop. And there was a tiered approach to how infrastructure would be required and developed, you know, as you moved further and further out from that boundary. So I think that's what the objection is that Ms. Tompkins referred to from the county commissioners. I agree that it's a point of discussion that we should continue with the county, because if we don't require infrastructure to get constructed when it comes time to annex, we're left holding the bag. Because we annexed the property, but the infrastructure hasn't been built, but there's already a development occurred, and so we have nothing left to require development of if everything gets built up right next to the city limits. So I understand that. So yes, that we should have discussions, but I hesitate to make it bigger than it needs to be.
Okay.
So I would think that if the staff were to discuss that and see if there's a way that they can come up with you know, a compromise or something like that that both sides could accept, then by the time we get to the third reading, we'll have that in front of us and we could actually do something like that and maybe get, make it go away at that point.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Councilor Ren.
I agree with Manager Bennett. There's got to be a way we can work this out and still, even though that we no longer really have as much say as we had before, I still think that this is going to be something we can work out, and I'd hate to see us have to come back after our 10 years and have to work on it again. If we can't get it fixed now, you know, we're going to end up staring it in the face, I'm sure, in 10 years. We'll probably have to. And then the other thing is, we're talking about not being fully developed and having to annex, and apparently at some time or another the city annexed the East Orchards and it wasn't fully developed. And now we have a big area out there in the East Orchards that's on septic tanks and not on sewer lines.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the kind of situation we might face again if we don't get this worked out.
Okay. Councilor Blakey.
I'm not sure who this question's to. Somebody, hopefully I'll ask it and somebody will answer it. Is it possible that we reopen our committee of nine, and have this discussion again at that level?
No.
No.
Okay.
We're way past the 180 days.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So are we still up for reading, or?
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
First reading. Yeah.
Okay. So all those in favor of reading Ordinance 4624 for the first time, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the first reading of Ordinance 4624 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Lewiston repealing Section 6.8 of the Comprehensive Plan of the City of Lewiston regarding the area of city impact, adopting a new Section 6.8, a statement of purpose, goals, and policies, adopting a reformatted Comprehensive Plan area map, and providing an effective date.
Okay, councilors, Ordinance 4624 has been read for the first time. Moving on to Ordinance 4625 for the first reading, amending the Comprehensive Plan Section 14, Community Design, eliminating the language regarding the area of city impact. Entertain a motion to read Ordinance 4625 for the first time.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion's been made and seconded. It's discussion. Okay, all those in favor of reading Ordinance 4625 for the first time, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the first reading of Ordinance 4625 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Lewiston amending the Comprehensive Plan of the City of Lewiston, Section 14, Community Design, eliminating the language regarding the area of city impact and providing an effective date.
Okay. Ordinance 4626 has been read, or 4625 has been read for the first time. Moving on to Ordinance 4626 for the first reading, enacting a new chapter to be codified as Chapter 39, providing for the orderly development of the City of Lewiston area city impact, providing for use zones within the area city impact, providing for the administration and enforcement of zoning and development within the area city impact. I'll entertain a motion to read Ordinance 4626 for the first time.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Is there a discussion? Okay, seeing none. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Approving the first reading of Ordinance 4626 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Lewiston, Idaho, enacting a new chapter to be codified as Chapter 39, providing for the orderly development of the City of Lewiston area of city impact, providing for use zones within the area of city impact, providing for conditional uses and variances, providing for supplemental regulations, exceptions, and amendments, providing for the administration and enforcement of zoning and development within the area of city impact, and providing an effective date.
Okay, ordinance 4626 has been read for the first time. Moving on to resolution 2015-8, adopting State of Idaho procedures for annexation of property into the city. I entertain a motion to approve, or is it read and approve?
You don't have to read it.
Approve. Approve resolution 2015.
So moved.
Motion and a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. 6-0. And now on to resolution 2015-9. This is adopting a revised area city impact boundary and map for the city as part of section 6.8 in the comprehensive plan. I'll entertain a motion to approve resolution 2015-9.
So moved.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Members of council? As you will note from all the maps from the area city impact, we still have that one single property that's completely surrounded by the city that I think needs to be taken out of the area city impact at some point. Either the city needs to consider annexing it or simply taking it out of the city. We've had this discussion before. There's no reason for that to be completely, it's totally isolated in the middle of the city.
I understand.
Talking about the one at the airport?
No, I'm talking about the one by Ziggy's.
Skinner's property. Yeah. That's right. It's a little tiny block right there. On
I will say that he did subscribe to fire service.
I'm sorry?
I will say that he did subscribe to fire service.
He did, but there's, I mean, we could, because he is completely surrounded by the city, we could do a forced annexation, but.
I understand. And. I hear what you're saying. I just don't know if we're at that position yet.
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Randall.
I think we should forego that at the moment, but keep that under advisement for a later date.
Yep. Yeah, I'd agree.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes. Councilor Blakey.
Question for council. With that piece of property being abutting the Warner Park, or Warner potential development there on Warner Avenue with Park there, would there be any illegal, what would that be a problem? Having county land bumping up against that city development, could we potentially be looking at a problem down the road, or would we need some county approval for some development? I'm just kind of thinking outside the box here.
No, as long as it's not contained inside our property, but it makes no land use or logical or legal sense to let it remain a part of the area some impact when it's completely surrounded by city.
Well, then my second question is, if you feel strongly about this, could you be presenting us an ordinance to do that? Or
I can't do that. If the council wants me to go forward with an annexation on it, when you
Well, at this time, I'm not looking forward to a forced annexation of anybody. Unless the council desires that. Okay.
Moving on.
All those in favor of approving resolution 2015-9, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Okay. Now, for ordinance 4620 for the first reading. This is amending Lewiston City Code Chapter 10, entitled Buildings and General Building Regulations, amending the International Building Code, International Residential Code, International Energy Conservation Code, International Mechanical Code, International Fuel Gas Code, Idaho Plumbing Code, and the International Electrical Code, providing for plan review fees. Entertain a motion to read ordinance 4620 for the first time.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there discussion?
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Randall.
Maybe we could talk about the plan review fees. Bring that up. What is expected for that?
Mr. Smith? Oh, or Laura? You want?
Plan review fees are set through a resolution that we have. Not sure how this became part of the first reading. It wasn't part of my ordinance that went through, other than it is identified through the building code process that we will have a plan review fee, and depending if it's residential or commercial, it depends on the percentage of the building permit fee as established either by valuation or by contract.
Councilor Randall.
So since we are changing the codes, if we adopt this, are we also changing the fees? Are they going to increase or are they going to stay the same?
The fees changed at the beginning of the new fiscal year as part of the resolution for those. This is not a change. That verbiage should not be in this document right here.
Thank you.
So we should strike that.
I'm sorry? There's no fee included in this ordinance. We adopt fees by schedule, and Mr. Smith's correct. We adopted that at the beginning of the fiscal year.
So this is just providing for planning.
Just provide to allow for.
Okay. Which we already have it by resolution. Okay.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure we understood that.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. So all in favor of reading ordinance 4620 for the first time, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Approving the first reading of ordinance 4620 by title only. An ordinance amending Lewiston City Code Chapter 10 entitled Buildings and General Building Regulations. Amending the International Building Code, International Residential Code, International Energy Conservation Code, International Mechanical Code, International Fuel Gas Code, the Idaho Plumbing Code, and the International Electrical Code, providing for plan review fees and providing an effective date.
Okay. Ordinance 4620 has been read for the first time. On to resolution 2015-10. This is approving an addendum to the collective bargaining agreement dated October 1, 2012 to September 30, 2015 between the city and the International Association of Firefighters, Local 1773, incorporating the provisions of a memorandum of understanding dated January 1, 2015. Mr. Bennett?
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. I'll have Fire Chief Travis Michael Bust come up and make a brief presentation on this. This has to do with impacts from the Affordable Care Act on how we classify reserve firefighters and how we ensure that we're in compliance with the ACA for as far as they're concerned.
Chief.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council. As Manager Bennett said, with the changes to the Affordable Care Act, effective January 1 of this year, due to the size of our city, those employees, when you go to a one calendar year look back that have averaged basically 1,560 hours, qualify to be eligible to be offered the medical coverage. And what we had looked at, and we had had this discussion as we went into the budget stuff, knowing this would be coming forward, of looking at what we have. And so we've worked with HR and also with the entity that we provide our medical coverage to make sure we are meeting all the statute and standards. And that's what this MOU is making sure we have the avenue for those individuals that qualify. We did have six members looking back in the past 12 months that did meet this requirement and were eligible. Five of those six employees have opted in. One of them did not. And so they do have that legal obligation to not opt into the coverage. You know, when we went back to budget, we did talk about the budgetary to the fire department this year was about $47,500 because of having to roll it in January that had some savings. Next year, we estimate, depending what the medical coverage does, It will be about $68,000 to the fire department budget, anticipating we have another six employees that would match this. We have looked at what it would take to stay under this element. That would take requiring a reserve to only work one day a week. To do that, to cover the maximum hours that we have, would probably look at us adding an additional 15 reserves to the current staff we have. I ran the numbers today, just so you know, to put 15 people through in a reserve academy, equip them, and train them would be about the sum of $120,000. And one of the things we worry about is we already struggled to get this reserve academy that we're going to start running on the 4th of February. We had to do the test twice just to get people to pass the physical agility. So trying to find 15 additional people besides the expense would definitely be an issue we'd be looking at. So we feel this is a viable option. I apologize to members, the administrative or the leadership staff of the local 1773 as a training, and so they're not in town, so they aren't able to be here tonight.
Okay. Questions for the chief? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve resolution 2015-10.
So moved. Second.
Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Next up, vouchers payable to Albertsons from January 1, 2015 through January 15, 2015 in the amount of $55.20. Entertain a motion to approve vouchers payable.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. And our final active agenda item, which would be item L. This is resolution 2015-10. And that would be...
Dash 11.
I'm sorry. 2015-11. This is an approving an addendum and appendices to the Memorandum of Understanding concerning the Lewiston Orchards project originally adopted on July 13, 2009 between the Lewiston Orchards Irrigation District, Nez Perce Tribe, Nez Perce County, City of Lewiston, and the Lewis-Clark Chamber of Commerce.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, you had this on your last agenda in a different format. They requested we put it in this format, so that's exactly the same information you've already adopted.
I just wanted to explain that the City of Lewiston is not going to be putting out any money. It's just that we're signing our name all on the original document concerning the transfer of water rights and stuff like
from
that.
From Sweetwater to the tribe.
Right.
From Lloyd. Okay. So all those in favor of approving resolution 2015-11, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. That concludes our active agenda. Moving on to unfinished and new business, city council comments. Do we have any city council comments this evening?
Mr. Mayor.
Council Randall.
I believe we have, do we have one more item, the short-term lease?
No, that has been pulled.
Okay.
For way of explanation, we were pursuing leasing the Semenicum Library to a private party, and their equipment wouldn't fit through the front door, so it is not feasible.
I just want to thank Mr. Bennett for putting on the work session on, I think, next week or whatever, the next couple of weeks, the issue about the Money Saver, and we've been exchanging emails with a constituent who's concerned about that being a littering issue, and I think it's a timely discussion, and I appreciate getting it up on the agenda so quickly.
And he's not the only one. I've received many phone calls, so we'll take a look at it.
Yes.
Other councilor comments?
Mr. Mayor.
Yeah.
I have a question for Mr. Bennett. There was a newspaper article that came out yesterday or last Thursday in the Lewiston Morning Tribune regarding the URA.
regarding the funds that were supposed to be dispersed to us. Did we get that money on Friday?
We did. Okay. We received a check in approximately $850,000 from the county with just basically a two-line letter that said, we're hereby dispersing these funds to the city. However, we are doing so under protest.
Can you explain why it was in the paper? There's a line here that says that the development director, community development director, surmised that the county might try to withhold the funds.
Let me just go back up and say, each week the county publishes its agenda for the coming week, and they meet virtually every day at one kind of meeting or another to go over county business. They had made a change to their agenda the previous week to put an item on their agenda for discussion on the payment of the fee to the city. So there was, without any further information, there was speculation that, you know, one of the outcomes of that could be that the county might decide not to make the payment. But that did not happen. They did, in fact, make the payment, but they did, however, make a statement that it was being made under protest.
Okay, thank you.
Other comments? Okay. Well, I don't really have any, but, one, I guess. Hopefully we can maybe tweak a few things on our area city impact over the next couple weeks. And
I mean, if that one item, and it's really one item, is all that stands between the city and the county from concluding the business that we've done, we should be able to fix that one item.
Yeah.
Okay. Councilor Miller. I have been approached by more than a dozen city employees about what we decided at our last work session with the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. All of them were unpleased that we decided to swap it with the day after Thanksgiving. So I would really appreciate us relooking at that again for maybe swapping it with Columbus Day. All of them were parents of students in the Lewiston School District.
Yeah, I can say that I've received a number of comments from the staff as well. And almost to a person, their preference would be to exchange the holiday for Columbus Day. And I think the main reason being that on Columbus Day, both the Clarkston and Lewiston school districts are open, as is the college. And so it's not really conducive to a family holiday, whereas the day after Thanksgiving creates a longer extended period at the holidays for families to get together and enjoy the holiday. So I will say that's the comments that I've received at this point.
Well, and I would agree with that, and I've received a bunch of those comments too. I will say, however, that there is a reason why people get plenty of holiday pay for the city of Lewiston. And if that is a day that they cherish and desire, I don't see why that couldn't be used as a paid vacation day, the day after Thanksgiving. And as long as there is a skeleton staff, maybe not everybody's traveling out of town.
Sure.
So we will have some discussions on this.
We have a year, basically, between.
So, and I'm not going to sweep it under the rug, but there are many people in this town that do work the day after Thanksgiving. So, you know, I guess I just have a fundamental problem with City Hall being closed for 4 days in a row. Maybe there's not going to be a lot of business done, but like I brought up, you know, banks are required to be open. They can't be closed 3 days. So what kind of message do we send that we're just going to close up for 4 days? Something we'll discuss.
Yep.
I guess.
Yeah. And just a comment on that. My understanding is Nez Perce County is open on the day after. They operate on the day after Thanksgiving. And I believe the state office is open on the day after Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, other government entities are up and running on the day after Thanksgiving. And I echo your comment there. I think we should be in lockstep, not necessarily with the vacation schedule of the schools, but more in lockstep with the government entities that we represent in parallel.
Sure, and the banks are open that day too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Bennett, any comments this evening?
Just to say that I'm encouraged by the fact that we're going to have a number of the members of the council going to Boise for the Association of Idaho Cities annual City Day at the Capitol. That's an opportunity for our legislators to meet with the city council to go over what they see happening in the legislature this session and some of the important bills that we will want to weigh in on. Just today, there were a couple of bills that surfaced that affect urban renewal. So certainly that's of great interest to the city. And of course, obviously, there's the ongoing hearings right at the moment on the Add the Words resolution dealing with sexual orientation and gender issues that the council dealt with last year. So it'll be a great opportunity to meet with Representative Rushi and Senator Johnson and Representative Rudolph down there. And the mayor will be attending, Councilor Blakey, Councilor Maldonado, Councilor Collins. I will be there as well. And as well as Administrative Services Director Dan Marsh. So I'm looking forward to a good meeting.
And I think AIC, I was asked to participate on their legislative committee, and I think we're going to have a little meeting after lunch down there as well. Mm-hmm. So hopefully we can get some things going our way, city-wise. Okay, on to advisory board and commission appointments. We have quite a few tonight. So would you like to start?
I have two for the Youth Advisory Commission. McKenna Barker and Damian Glenn.
Okay. We have a motion to appoint McKenna Barker and Damian Glenn to the Youth Advisory Commission.
So move.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you.
Councilor Blakey, do you have one?
Oh, yes. Thank you. On urban renewal, we have an opening, and we have not an opening, but we have a request to renew, and that is Butch Alford.
Okay.
He would like to re-up his term on urban renewal.
That's in terms of a motion?
That is a motion.
You have a second?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes. Oh,
sorry, I have a question regarding that. Is Mr. Alford's position an at-large position, or is it the Valley Vision position? He is an at-large. He's not the Valley Vision. I thought that was Joe Hewlett and Mary Jo, or Joanne.
Yeah.
Mary Jo represents the board.
Yeah, I'm not clear on that myself, because I thought he was the Valley Vision representative, and like Joe and
Joanne Hohans
are the two at-large.
I believe that's correct.
Yes, yes.
So traditionally for appointments to the URA, don't we, like if it's a county representative, don't they have to get a letter of recommendation from the county or from the port? So we don't need a letter of recommendation for Valley Vision?
I'm not familiar with us ever having done that before. It isn't to say that we couldn't ask for that, but generally Valley Vision, decides among their directors, who they would recommend representing them on the URA board. But I can't tell you whether the Valley Vision Board has had that specific discussion or not.
And that did not come up for discussion in our meeting when he asked to be reappointed, and we approved it.
Was anyone from Valley Vision there to put in that recommendation at the time that you voted on it?
There was no recommendation. There was, Mr. Mattoon was in attendance, and he did not object. He was in attendance, and he did not object at the meeting.
Okay. I have nothing personal against Mr. Alford. I was just wondering if we needed to hear something from Valley Vision before we vote on, in case there's another representative from Valley Vision that they'd like to serve, or I guess if the URA's already voted on it, then. Just throwing that out there.
Well, Mr. Mattoon is the executive director of Valley Vision, so I would assume that if there had been discussion about that, he would have been able to shed some light on that. So,
yes. He was not asked.
No.
He was not asked.
But he was present and
he was present.
Understood what the appointment was.
Uh-huh. Well, what's your pleasure? Want to table this to the next meeting? Or?
Like I said, I have nothing against Mr. Alfred. I'd just like to hear something from Valley Vision confirming that that's the representative that they want.
Mr. Mayor, why don't we table this and ask Manager Bennett to send a letter to or email to
Mr.
Mattoon and get him to send a mail confirming it.
Okay. You okay with that?
Sure, I'll check with Mr. Mattoon.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, let's see. Moving down the line, you're up.
We have one opening, soon to be two openings, on the Transportation Advisory Commission. We actually, the subcommittee panel interviewed three different candidates, and we have our first candidate for the first position, and that's Sue Brown. I'd like to move that we approve Sue Brown for TAC. Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, and on behalf of Councilor Daniel, he had asked me to entertain a motion to reappoint Jim Jenkins and Dan Prazzle to the Parks and Recreation Committee.
Second.
I didn't
or
make
am I
the
moving?
Motion.
I would like to
entertain
move.
Entertain them. Thank you.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Three-point Jim Jenkins, Dan Prazzle, Parks and Rec. All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay, motion carries 6-0. And then I will entertain a motion to reappoint Gail McGarry and Jerry Bateman to the Planning and Zoning Commission.
So moved.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, I think that's about it, unless we have any more.
I've got one more.
Well, you do.
For the Solid Waste Advisory Commission, we have a reappointment request for Sean McCabe.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor of reappointing Sean McCabe to the SWAC, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Just a reminder, we still have two positions open.
We still have two positions open. Anybody that's interested, please contact Carrie at City Hall. Okay, moving on to work session agenda topics. I think we have a pretty good work session coming up. We actually have one on Monday, and then we'll have our budget work session towards the end of the month.
Correct, on the 28th of February. Right.
Okay. Isn't there not also a meeting to hear our audit?
Yes, the audit meeting will be held on February 9th. The preliminary meeting will be in work session at 4 o'clock at City Hall, and then followed by a brief formal presentation of the audit at the regular council meeting that evening.
Anything else? Okay, with that, we'll adjourn this meeting. Thank you, everybody.